And welcome back to another episode of Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I'm the RPG Chick. We're about to enter the Defiance Bay area. Oh, triumphant music. The Copperlane, district? Road? Something? Yeah, we can only go there. Copperlane. Alright, let's check it out. 15 minutes. Well, I don't think we can handle it after traveling for days from Cadnua. I think we'll be alright.
Defiance Bay. The city at the heart of the Deerwoods Revolution now seems on the brink of another. Refugees line the streets, homeless and hungry, displaced by Whitewind's legacy, hoping for relief within the city walls, and finding none. Dissidents congregate to protest and to heckle, calling for an end to animancy and the ouster of their duke. The city's militiamen cast fearful looks as they patrol the streets, their hands trembling at the hilts of their weapons. The capital of a country that had not long ago incinerated a god now appears to be a spark away from sharing the deity's fate.
Awesome. I was not expecting that.
Sure.
Well, seems like quite a place we have here. Full of strife and interesting crap going on. What is he doing, trying to open that box? If you need an inn for the night, Goose and Fox has the softest beds and the best ale. Let me show you how it's done.
Margrin's fire casts light in dark places.
Those
walls surround the city, yeah. What is Black Sun? Concerned someone might see us even though their backs are turned, does that count? A common sight in the Deerwood, Black Sun is fashioned from sunreed liquor and the boiled sap from Glamfellen trees. It's known to lend a sense of heightened alertness to the user, though it leaves one feeling worn and lethargic once it wears off. I'm gonna leave it.
Its walls surround the whole city.
Let this guy get in trouble. We just got here. Have you been to the Expedition Hall yet? You might find your type of work there. Yeah, someone told us that outside the gate before. Yep, we've seen that too. I'm sure there's plenty to see and do here. We need more reasonable people in Defiance Bay. I am not reading the ones you've already read, by the way. A cat! Hail, cat! Who knows? It might be the most intelligent being in this place. Refugee. I didn't want to come here, but my village wasn't safe anymore. But you don't have to live like a refugee. Sorry. Don't everybody unsubscribe at once, just to CR. The expeditions out of Admeth's den are just organized grave robbery. Noted, sir. Noted. Stay out of the catacombs. They're more dangerous than usual lately. Protester, huh? I saw an animancer's experiment make a little girl kill herself. The Duke says he's addressing the animancy problem, but nothing ever changes. Man isn't meant to tinker with souls. I'll bet animancy is to blame for every problem in the city. She looks important. I'll get to her last. The Hall of Revealed Mysteries is where you want to go if you need the services of a scholar. Rowan. Rowan's arms are crossed, and his mouth is set in a grim frown as he watches the gathered protesters. He looks ready for a fight. He sizes you up. New in town, eh? You've picked an interesting time to visit Defiance Bay. All these refugees fleeing the frontier and finding the legacies no better here. It's the animancers, Magrin scorch 'em, and they nest in this city like rats. You mark my words, though. Us dozens are going to put a stop to it. Tell me about the dozens. He taps his chest. We're an organization of interested citizens who want to free Defiance Bay from the dangerous influence of animancers and the tyranny of the aristocrats who support them. We also consider ourselves a militia of sorts, seeing as the Crucible Knights are little more than a flock of preening nobles in training these days. Edir says, just like a militia, the dozens, except for the training, and the discipline, and the code of honor. His eyes gleam, and we're always looking to expand. The more people see things our way, the better for the state of the country. You have any interest in hearing more, stop by Admeth's Den sometime. The Expedition Hall. A lot of free thinkers in there can set straight all the nonsense the nobles and the animancers want you to believe. Might even be some paid work there for motivated types. What are you doing out here? I mean, personally, I guess. He gestures at the crowd, which buzzes with angry chatter. Trying to get folk to see reason. We're in the midst of a crisis, and instead of purging the nefarious forces from our city, the Duke is granting animancers dangerous liberties. What do you know about animancy? It's the study and manipulation of essence, which any sane person will tell you is the purview of the gods. The Adirans at least... Sorry, guys. At least had the sense to outlaw it, which is the only good thing you can say about them. It's not like magic, chanting, or the soul readings those ciphers do. It's been around since ancient Ngwythan times, which is why you'll see animancers tinkering with old Ngwythan artifacts. Kanna raises a fist to cough discreetly into it. Half-truths, all. But he's an enthusiastic performer, I'll give him that. Rowan shakes his head. Trouble is, the animancers got no idea what half those artifacts actually do. Not that they'll admit it. Aloth says, our emphatic friend is correct about one thing at least. Well, our companions seem to have a lot to say about all this. That's why I left Firebrand behind, which is a character I created. She went back to the Stronghold. And, our story-related characters are here. I'd like to know more about Defiance Bay. This is the capital of the Free Palatinate of the Deerwood. That's a new word for me. We started out as the capital of an Adirian colony, but we booted the flaccid scepter from these lands 150 years ago. These days, we're a major port receiving trade and visitors from all over the world. But we... some of us, anyway, strive to hold on to the pioneering spirit that earned us our freedom a century and a half ago. The city is divided into five districts: Copperlane, First Fires, Andra's Gift, Brackenbury, and Heritage Hill. He ticks each off on a calloused finger. Well, we're in Copperlane. Tell me about Copperlane. This here is Copperlane. He taps a scuffed boot on the cobblestones. It's primarily a market district, but you've also got the Expedition Hall directly north of here, where you can join treks into the wilds. That's also where my fellow Dozens Martyrs and I tend to meet up with other concerned citizens. I guess we're getting trek. We can get quests there. He points to a long dome building west and north of your position, and that's the Hall of Revealed Mysteries. Eerie place, you ask me, but they've got the biggest library in the Deerwood. Northwest. Okay, so up there somewhere. Kanna laughs. Eerie indeed. It might be less so if more kith stepped inside. Perhaps we ought to visit Theodess and see just what mysteries are revealed. Tell me about Brackenbury. Noise of disgust rattles in his throat. The nobility that didn't sail back to Adir stayed there. Most of the families there trace their lineage back to old imperial times. Other than a lot of has-been nobility, you've got Hadrit House, where Lady Webb and her spies operate, and Brackenbury Sanitarium, the main cesspit of animancy in the city. He spits on the cobblestones. Tell me about First Fires. That's where the revolution started, hence the name. These days it's overrun with politicians and panderers, but we'll take it back someday. That's where you'll find the Ducal Palace, the Valian Embassy, and Crucible Keep. He shakes his head. The Crucible Knights were the original freedom fighters in Defiance Bay, but now they're just strutting peacocks with their eyes on fancy titles and their heads up their asses. There's an old Temple of Vortica there, too. We keep it real nice for her. He winks. Tell me about Andra's gift. Got the name because it was a wetland that was drained back in the Imperial days. Now it's a seedy district populated by sailors, common folk, and more than a few thugs, but it's a fun place too if you know where to look. He winks and elbows you. Look for a place called the Salty Mast when you're there. Other than that, it's mostly warehouses and abandoned homes. Tell me about Heritage Hill. He shivers. It used to be one of the more prestigious districts in the city. Heroes of the revolution claim plots up there next to an ancient Inguithan tower and the city cemetery. Had the best views in Defiance Bay. Attracts richer types these days. Lot of animancy patrons. He spits. He glances at the crowd and lowers his voice. You wouldn't have heard, but something happened over there a couple months ago. The authorities sealed it off and they're keeping their mouths shut. But mark my words, animancy's to blame. Farewell. I thought she was the important one. I'll bet animancy is to blame for every problem in the city. Somehow I don't think it's that clear cut.
Keeping an eye out.
Oh, this is back at the beginning. I thought I'd run farther than this for some reason. Well, we can't walk on the grass. That much is clear. And this ends over here. So we're crossing this here. Well, the calm waters smell faintly of refuse. Copperlane Marketplace is everything you could ever want to buy. I've seen that before. Wow. Okay, a lot to explore just in this district alone. Goose and Fox. Let's check it out. More stories. Yep. You see a fire burning slowly on the side of a winding road, unmanned. There seems to be no fuel, no wood or oil for it to consume, no hay or twigs. Despite this, it roars, crackles, wails in the wind. It takes you a moment, but you begin to notice a figure in the flames. Its shaking hands cradle a young face, molten red tears marring skin the color of coal. The boy cowers, flame coating him as he holds his knees to his chest. In the distance, a man approaches, faceless. He extends a hand to the frightened child, who considers it warily before taking it. The flames die down, leaving his limbs and settling on his head like obedient pets. All tears dried, they walk together, fire and death, hand in hand. So fire and death godlike. And that's Irish T. Tungsten. His Micarus Salamatine. You see a wizard playing illusions in the town square, fingers plucking color and sound from the air in weaving scenes of beauty and fright. A crowd of onlookers gasps and cheers, enthralled with the display. All but one boy standing off to the side, mouth agape. Green eyes are pale with wonder, vision after vision playing out before him, and something inside the boy clicks. Without warning, he bolts, disappearing into the crowd, pushing and shoving desperately. The mage finishes his show soon after, a giant silver dragon descending through the crowd and a thousand stars exploding into nothingness. Collecting coins, he walks, around the clapping crowd, bowing and nodding at each as he passes, until a small sack is dropped into his hands. The boy stands for a moment before him, small and still, and begs the wizard to apprentice him. He glances at the hefty bag, weighing it, and the boy, carefully. Finally, he nods and flicks gently at the bag, which disappears. The boy grins. "How'd you do that?" he asks. He quotes there, but the illusionist merely winks. Oh, that's it. And the vulture. I wish I could talk to the vulture. Sounds interesting. I wish I could talk to these people. You see a hand, curled and bruised, staked to the floor, with a bent metal spike. Blood covers the floor and drips from the furnishings and walls. This man looks up from the body he has crouched over to survey the carnage he caused to the family in whose house he now skulks. 4 bodies total, a woman, 2 young men, and a girl, lie blindfolded on the ground. Their legs are bound and both hands are attached to the floor with spikes. He has lifted the woman's blindfold and is currently doing something to her eyes. He pulls back a small blade and covers the eyes again, gently patting the blindfold. He stands and looks around, seemingly satisfied with his handiwork. Suddenly his breath quickens, hearing someone approach the door to the room. He bounces in place, excitement almost overwhelming him, then rushes to the back of the room, concealing himself in the shadows. From his From his vantage, he sees the bodies are perfectly arranged, each one facing the door, welcoming the man of the house back, arms outstretched as if in embrace. The door opens as he slowly pulls another spike from his belt, the tip of his tongue playing across his teeth in anticipation. That's the vulture? I'd actually really like to kill this guy if that was him. Hold on one moment, guys. I'm going to silence this phone. I thought it was already silenced, but... Okay, now it is. My apologies. Okay, so we've got an actress. Welcome to the Goose and Fox. You find all sorts. Everyone's a philosopher here. Lively place, isn't it?
Welcome.
The man behind the bar is nearly the size of an Omawa. A handle protrudes from his back, and his face is set in a stoic frown. He gives you a small nod. Here for a drink? There's a tiny pewter cup in front of him. He turns it in one broad hand, but doesn't drink from it. This is a lively place. It was founded in the early days of Deerwooden independence by a traveling scholar named Errol of Levi. He wanted a place where kith of all backgrounds could gather and hash out the issues facing their new country. He rests his elbows on the polished wood of the bar. It didn't take long for the place to fill up. Brackenberry aristocrats agreed with dock workers from the gift, while soldiers wrangled with politicians. Deerwoodens have never been known to turn down an argument. He takes a sip from the tiny cup. What happened next? Soon, kith were coming from the farms and settlements, too. He waves at the door, as if expecting a crowd to bustle in. This place got even more popular with the Valian sailors than the Salty Mast, and that was the problem. He drains his cup. No matter what people say about fair-mindedness and civil debate, there's only so much people will tolerate. Errol found himself on the wrong side of an argument with the wrong thane, and when he disappeared a few days later, some said it was the work of that thane. Hold on a sec. Oh my god. Okay, just want to check, see how many minutes we're in. He shrugs, spreading his hands over the bar as he surveys the room. But Errol knew which way the wind was blowing. If you ask me, he skipped town, hid out somewhere, hoping for rational minds to prevail in Defiance Bay. He cracks a wry grin. If only he could see it now. Tell me about yourself. Name's Bishop. Used to be a scholar of Barath. Now I run the Goose and Fox and keep the regulars in line. He shifts, and you see a warhammer strapped to his back. What more is there to tell? How'd you go from religion to taverns? The journey isn't as long as you'd think. It started with Hollowborn, and with this. He takes a black bottle from under the bar and fills the pewter cup. It was my sister's son. He takes a drink. At the beginning of Widewind's legacy, he was one of the first. I never expected there would be so many after him. Tragedy is part of the cycle, but it's followed by rebirth. Yet every year, more parents were grieving for their hollowborn children, and the gods were silent. So you lost your faith? He leans forward, crossing his arms on the bar. Barath promises rebirth, cycles, but the only cycle I found was this one. He taps the bar. Have a drink? Have another. And another until I couldn't remember how I got home. Wake up. Come back. I finally woke up one day to see my family had packed up and left. For all I know, they'd left days before and I just hadn't noticed. But they were gone, so I came here. I've cleaned up since then. Not that I've found my answers. He tosses the cup back. I've just stopped asking questions. Order some. Could I order some refreshments? I just want to see what he has. He's got camping supplies. Darkest Rortai cookies. Rivaled only by Adarians in their love of sweet things, the Rortai count many delicious desserts and rich treats among their famed recipes. One of the most revered by wealthy connoisseurs around the known world is the Darkest Rortai chocolate cookie. It has become a courtesy gift among Rortai ambassadors, with many foreign dignitaries warmly receiving any Rortai delegations simply in the hopes of receiving a batch of the revered treats. Iximitil rice pan? Popular as a dinner entree in the Iximitil, I think, plains, the Iximitil rice pan has hundreds of regional and family variations. Varied as it may be, the dish is often seen as a great unifier in a culture heavily stratified by social hierarchy. Philosophers and wealthy politicians may use rare spices or finer cheeses, but its basic ingredients and ease of cooking have made it a traditional meal for all Iximitil people. At Iximitil wedding celebrations, it is common for the family's close friends and family to spend the previous day cooking enough Iximitil rice pan to feed everyone in the celebration to come. They really added a lot. Savory pie, a delicious smelling pie with a golden crust and meat filling guaranteed to leave one feeling battle ready. Duke's own beet loaf. They've got a lot of lore to this game. Holy crap. Beef, did I say beet loaf? Beef loaf. Beef loaf is a standard dish all across the Deerwood, and hundreds of families have been using the same recipe for generations. No one is quite sure how it came to be known as the Duke's Own, but two legends are widespread. The first involves Admeth Hadrett, the Deerwood's first duke, personally making beef loaf for his captive prisoner, the Glanfathan Galvin Regid. The Orlin was supposedly so fond of his meal that he asked for the recipe and passed it on to his kith after his release. The second more likely tale features an unscrupulous cook who worked for the venerable Black Hound Inn of Gilded Vale. She confided in myriad travelers that she had a recipe for the Duke's own beef loaf, simply her own delicious recipe, and sold it to dozens of people for outrageous prices. Each victim of the ruse went on to make their beef loaf with the Duke's own recipe, giving rise to the popular name. So this might have started over in the Black Hound. That's interesting. Pearlwood chicken. Hope you guys don't mind I read all this crap. It is lore, right? Pearlwood chicken is common among the settlers along the Pearl Coast and Defiance Bay, but its popularity has not spread far north or abroad. Locals claim that the dwarves of Telenir were responsible for inventing the dish. Given the odd assembly of ingredients, often a notable feature of dwarven cuisine, many are inclined to accept the claim at face value. There are rumors that the Duke of Osea has become fond of Pearlwood chicken, supposedly using gray breast chickens imported live all the way from Old Valia to suit his particular tastes. As the dish is not yet popular in the Valian Republics, the citizens of Osea are not sure if they should try to emulate the Duke's rumored style or vigorously deny it to foreigners. Rortai sweet pie. Popular in all the coastal communities of Rautai, sweet pie is often considered too rich even by their standards. It is saved for special occasions. One of the most notable and worthy occasions is when a Rautai Omawa makes his or her first long journey across the ocean. Upon returning, his friends and family members often share a sweet pie with the returning youngster, enjoying the first piece. You can buy a dog. A yellow lab. Cheese. I remember seeing cheese. An odorous, crumbly wedge of cheese, perfect for luring rats and dinner guests alike. A silver-scaled fish, fresh caught. Dear wooden legend suggests that eating fish eyes makes you more clever, though they didn't seem to help the fish any. I just want to get out of the sea. Oh, yeah, we could use some camping supplies.
Welcome.
Oh, wait. Supposedly he only had three, but I'm not sure if that's just because we only needed three. Bodyguard. Nothing loosens tongues like a good pint. You hear this guy? Mad, I tell ya. Are you here for some words of wisdom, too? Dunno. A drunk mercenary. It's a good place to unwind between jobs. Sometimes I even find new ones. Who's this? Canara? Let's talk to Canara. Is there anything to look at here? There's a bed or something there. A dragon is outlined in charcoal pencil. The thick, jagged lines and the faint smell of sulfur suggest that the artist completed this sketch in a hurry. Cliff Dragon, White March, 2685. That miserable bastard. A woman sits by herself, spinning something on a table in front of her and watching it with furious intensity. It's about the size of a coin, and it wobbles over a crack in the wood with a metallic rattle. She snatches it up with one hand and slams a half-empty cup down on the table with the other. This is not a good time. You look like you could use another drink. I'll get there. She takes a long drink from her glass, just trying to calm down and trying to talk myself out of something foolish. Something foolish? She says nothing for a few moments, as if hoping you'll leave. At last... Did I say Canara? Canara? Canara looks up at you, and lamplight falls across her face. A purpling bruise is blossoming along her cheekbone. There's something I need to give to my fiancé, Pranisk, only he doesn't seem to go anywhere without his new friends, and they're not exactly pleasant company. Who hit you? She shakes her head. I know how this looks, but you don't understand. It's not like Pranisk. It's these new friends of his. They've brought out the worst in him. Tell me about these new friends. They come into our house with their dead eyes and their black teeth. I'm not a fool. I know what it means. Pranisk makes me leave when they show up, but it's obvious what they come to do. Last time they came, I told them to get out. Let them have their fun somewhere in the gift, but not under my roof. She scowls and then winces, her fingertips gently probing her bruise. Svef changes you, I guess. The Pranisk I knew wouldn't have squashed a spider. I never thought he'd... She trails off, still feeling the swollen, discolored flesh. Now, I could use Intellect 10, but I don't know what Svef is, so I would rather her tell us. What's Svef? I don't see the joke. She eyes you suspiciously. You really don't know? It's a shrub, I think, from out in the mountains somewhere. It has dark berries, and they treat them somehow. Make this pulpy paste. You rub it into your gums, and you're supposed to see. I don't know. Amazing things. Your own soul. People who use it, that's all they do. They lay around seeing things for days. It seems stupid to say 2 and 3 here because I just found out what Svef is. Have you gone to the Crucible Knights? To tell them my fiancé hit me? She shakes her head. They'll just tell me to stay away from him. They've got too many other problems to worry about a domestic dispute. Maybe I could go talk to him. Her hand rests on the table, and she clenches it into a white-knuckled fist. There's nothing more to say to him. We're finished. I just want to give this back to him and have a clean break. She opens her hand, and a ring clatters onto the table. They should have made that sound. That would have been cool. It was his grandmother's. Even after this, I don't have the heart to sell it off. But if I go back there myself, I know what'll happen. I lose my temper, and I'll probably wind up with another one of these. She points to her bruise. I'll take this ring to Pernisk, then. She looks at you and nods. The house is just north of here. Just please don't hurt him. As furious as I am, I don't want that on my conscience. Okay. We have a quest. Let's take a look in here. There's stuff to look at. A dwarf and an Orlin debate philosophy on the other side of this curtain. An actor. You've come to talk some sense into this fellow, I hope? Hate to say it, but the legacy's been good for business. The painting depicts Glamfellen ruins, and the canvas bears the rough brushstrokes of a talented amateur. Ibrell's Well, 2665. Brad Furis? Another history. You see a mud-soaked clearing, rain falling to the ground in large drops. This man is laying on his back in the muck, his hands holding open the maw of an enormous Stalgar that stands over him, its front paws on his chest. What the hell's a Stalgar? The heavy man falls over them, playing counterpoint to the grunts made by the opponents. Dead Stalgar litter the ground around them, and the man's body shows signs of a difficult battle. His clothing is torn, hanging in scraps in some places. Bites and scratches cover his arms and legs. A huge gash cuts across his forehead, blood and water mixing as they run down his face and drip into the mud. It takes all the man's effort to keep the beast's jaws from clamping down. The man looks around wildly until his gaze finally lands on a large axe lying barely within arm's reach behind his head, the rain slowly covering it with grime and muddy water. He looks at the Stalgar and then back at his axe, grim determination on his face. His arms are shaking, and it seems he will not be able to hold the beast back for much longer. He takes a deep breath and wraps his right hand around the Stalgar's bottom jaw, then lets go with his left hand, freeing the top of its head. The Stalgar's mouth snaps shut on its right hand, on his right hand, and his left shoots out above his head and grabs the handle of his axe. The Stalgar grinds its teeth and pulls back, trying to free itself from his grip, blood dripping from its mouth onto his face. With a grunt that quickly becomes a bellow of pain, the man pulls his right hand down, bringing the beast's head closer to him, swinging the axe around as he does. The blade of the weapon pierces the Stalgar's neck, and it yelps, its mouth popping open as it tries to step backward off of the man. Before his mangled hand can lose its grip, the man pulls and twists as hard as he can, trying to get the beast on the ground, using the Stalgar's resistance to pull himself into a sitting position. He brings the axe down on its neck again, and again, and one final time as its head and his hand simultaneously come free. The head flies from his grip as he thrusts his hand behind his back to brace himself as he falls. I'm trying to picture all this, you know? It's a little difficult. As his hand hits the ground and his full weight lands on it, a second bellow of pain erupts from his mouth. Breathing heavily, he brings his now mangled hand up to assess the damage. The little finger is gone, lost somewhere in the mud. The two fingers next to it are twisted, broken, and torn, barely attached to his hand by small bits of flesh. He sighs, grabbing both dangling fingers with his left hand. He grits his teeth and pulls. Ow. Owie. That's an owie. Ooh, is there no one in here? We can get stuff.
Light, flame, and sound. We'll keep to ourselves.
Mead, sure. Our cleric can take care of this.
I can do that.
A bartender's ring. Preservation. Plus 20 defense while stunned. Plus 20 defense while prone. Huh. This simple wooden ring is orange and gray, and it glows when you're not wearing it. The ring's actual history is more speculation than fact. While all sources agree that it was owned by Errol of Levi and that he acquired it after a period of exile, stories differ on the particulars of how he got it. Some say it was a gift from one of the gods, and others say it was the boon of a pact he made with wicked power. It was pretty handy to have. He's got room for a ring. Throw that on there. There you go. Okay, we've explored well most of this place. Still have to go look at this area and upstairs, I guess. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.